Hello everyone. So today we'll be doing model test section 5, and my name is Mohammad Rafiq Suhail. So for the first question, quantity A is 1 over pi, so we can write this as 1 over 3.142 and 1 over under root 10. So under root 10 is a number that is 3.16. Now 3.16 is greater than 3.142. So if we divide 1 by 3.16 by a greater number, when we divide 1 by a greater number than 3.142, hence quantity B would be less. So this quantity would be lesser than quantity A. So quantity A is greater than quantity B. And you also need to know this concept. For example, we have 1 over A and 1 over B. Now let's suppose A and B both are positive numbers. So if A is less than B, then this quantity would be greater. So for example, 1 over 2 and this is 1 over 4. So this is 0.5 and this is 0.25. The denominator is greater than the denominator over here. Hence the total value would be less. So 0.5 is greater than 0.25. But over here, under root 10 is 3.16. So 1 over 3.16 is less as compared to 1 over 3.142. Hence option A is correct. Now N is an odd positive integer between 700 to 800. Now the number of the prime factors of n and the number of prime factors of 2n. So we know that this number that is between 700 and 800 is an odd positive integer. And the number of prime factors of this n, for example, we take this as 707. It's an odd number. It's between 700 and 800. So the prime factors would be, the first one would be 1. The other one would be 7. So if we divide 7 by 7 and 7, we are left with 101. So the other prime factor would be, or the other factor would be 101. So these two are prime factors. Now the number of prime factors of 2n. So if we have 2n, then there's this addition of 2. So we are multiplying 2 by n. So these factors would remain. But we would going to have an additional factor of 2, because 2 multiplied by an odd number, we're going to give you an even number. So one additional factor would be 2. So the number of prime factors of 2n, so over here we'll be having additional factor of 2. So the quantity B would be greater than quantity A. So for example, over here we have 707 multiplied by 2. This would become 1414. So the addition, so the first factor would be 1. So we have additional factor now that is 2. So 1414 can be divided by 2 and it will going to leave no remainder. The other two factors would be 7 and 101. So we have additional factor that is 2. Hence quantity B would be greater than quantity A. Hence option B is correct. Now X is less than Y. So the average arithmetic mean between X and Y. So X plus Y divided by 2, and Y is greater than X. So let's suppose X is 5 and Y is 10. So the mean would be 7.5. So it's a number in between these two numbers. So 10 plus 5 is 15 divided by 2 is 7.5. And the average arithmetic mean of X, Y and Y. So 5 plus 10 plus 10. Now divide by 3 would be 25 divided by 3. That would be 8 point something. Now obviously the tilt would be towards 10 because we have 5, 10 and 10. So the average would be tilted towards 10. So quantity B would be greater than quantity A. Hence option B is correct. Now quantity A is C and quantity B is D. So C is this angle and D is this angle. So the opposite side of C is greater than the opposite side of D. Hence C angle would be greater than D angle. So option A is correct. Now A is less than B but greater than 0. So A percent would be A over 100 into 1 over B. That is A over B 100. And this would be B percent into 1 over A. So we can write this as B over A 100. Now A is a smaller number than B. So numerator is smaller and denominator is bigger. over here b is greater than the b is greater than a, so numerator is bigger than the denominator, hence quantity b would be greater. And again, the denominator is lower, so whenever we divide a denominator that is low, it will going to give you a higher number as compared to if we divide a denominator that is higher. So over here this number would be greater than this number, and over here b, that is the numerator, that is greater than a, hence option b is correct. Now over here we have this triangle, this is x and this is y. Now don't get confused with the diagram, it seems that this is dividing the triangle into two parts, so this angle would be 80. So x and y, it might seem that it would be divided into two parts, that would be 40 and 40. How do we get this 80? Because we have these two angles that are 50, and the total angles in a triangle, they are 180. So 180 minus 100, that is 50 plus 50 would be 80. But this triangle, now over here, it seems that this is a straight line, but this can also be like this. This triangle, this line can also be a bit tilted. So we are not sure which angle is greater. So don't get confused with the diagram. So the diagram is made in such a way to confuse you. It might seem that it is dividing the triangle into two parts, equal parts, but we are not 100% sure about it. So we can't tell. So option D is correct. The line L passes through these two points, and line M is perpendicular to line L. Now there's this concept. So if we have this line having a gradient of, let's suppose, X, so the perpendicular gradient would be minus 1 over X. So we multiply it by minus. So right now, line L passes through these two points. So what will be the gradient? So the formula for gradient is Y2 minus Y1 divided by X2 minus X1. So this would be minus under root 3 minus under root 3 divided by under root 2 minus minus under root 2 would be, we are going to add them up. But the main thing to understand is that the gradient of this line is negative. So it's a downward sloping line. So the perpendicular line would be like this, cutting it from upward. So this gradient or this line is M. So the gradient of M would be positive. So the slope is negative for line L, and the slope is positive for line M. So quantity B would be greater than quantity A, hence option B is correct. Now in the figure below, what is the average of the measures of five angles? So how many angles there are? 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So there are 360 degrees in an angle. So 360 divided by 5 equals to 72. So option D is correct. Now we need to understand that despite that this circle is not cut in equal angles, but the average would be 360 divided by number of angles. So we have 5 different angles. Now, Camille's average on a 6 maths test. So we have 6 tests. So A, B, C, D, E, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, F. So the average, so A plus B plus C plus D plus E plus F, the average of all these 6 tests were 75. So the total number, if we add all the numbers of these 6 tests, they would equal to 75 into 6 equals to 450. Now, her teacher drops each student's lowest grade, and this raises her average to 85. Now, let's suppose this test, you scored the lowest. So this score is dropped. So B plus C plus D plus E plus F, these are the 5 tests which are now counted. So divide by 5 and you get an average of 85. So B plus C plus D plus E plus F equals to 85 into 5. So 85 into 5, so 85 into 5, 80 into 5 is 400, and 5 fives are 25, so it's 425. So these, all these five tests, you have 425 marks. The total marks you got was 550 when we were adding all six. So A, how much you have scored in this first test or in A test? So this would be 25. So 25 plus 525 equals to 450. So the correct answer is B. Now, if the area of a rectangle is 40, which of the following could be the perimeter of the rectangle? So square is a type of a rectangle, and the smallest perimeter will be that of the square. Now, we can have as big as a perimeter if we are talking about rectangles. So for example, if the area of a rectangle is 40, so we can have this 40 and we can have this as 1. So the area is 40 and the perimeter is 40 plus 40 plus 1 plus 1, that is 82. We can also have like this. So we have one length is 0.80 and one side is 0.5. So again, the area is 40, but the perimeter is 80 plus 80, 160. So 160 plus 1 is 161. So we can have as big as the perimeter that can be. Now the smallest perimeter is that of a square. So if we have x and x, so x squared equals to 40, x would be under root 40. So the perimeter would be 4 into under root 40. Or we can say 4 into 10. This, if this 4 goes out, this will become 2. So 8 into under root 10. So we know that this under root 10 would be a number that is more than 3. So the perimeter would be more than 24. So this is the smallest perimeter that can be. So this cannot be the right answer. So the smallest perimeter is at least 24 or 24 plus. So the perimeter 20 will not exist. A perimeter with a number of 20 will not exist. So all these perimeters might be possible. Now, which of the following is an equation of a line that is perpendicular to the line whose equation is 2x plus 3y equals to 4? So we can write 2x plus 3y equals to 4. So we can write this as 3y equals to minus 2x plus 4. Or y equals to minus 2 upon 3x plus 4 upon 3. So the gradient is minus 2 by 3. Now the perpendicular gradient, so if this line has a gradient of minus 2 by 3, the perpendicular would be plus 3 by 2. You just flip it. So if we have x as a gradient, so the perpendicular gradient would be minus 1 over x. So if x is minus 2 by 3, minus 1 over x would be plus 3 by 2. Now we need to find out the equation that would be having a gradient of 3 by 2. So this would be 2y equals to minus 3x. So this cannot be possible because this gradient would be minus 3 by 2. So this cannot be the right answer. This would be 3x minus 2y. So this would be minus 2y equals to minus 3x plus 4. Now this might seem a possibility. So this would be y equals to 3 by 2 because minus minus we're going to cancel out. So this can be a possibility. And you need to also know this concept. Y equals to mx plus c. So this m is your gradient. For example, over here, we can write minus 2y equals to minus 3x plus 4. Multiply both sides by minus 1. So this would be 2y equals to 3x minus 4. So y equals to 3 upon 2x minus 4 upon 2. So this gradient is 3 by 2. So this can be a possibility because the gradient over here was minus 2 by 3. So the perpendicular gradient would be 3 by 2. So this would be minus 3y equals to minus 2x plus 4. So y would be, so the gradient over here would be 2 by 3. So this cannot be the right answer over here. So minus 2y equals to minus 3x plus 4. So we can write this equation as minus 2y equals to minus 3x plus 4. multiply both sides by minus 1. So this would be 2y equals to 3x minus 4. Again, y equals to 3 upon 2x minus 4 upon 2. So again, the gradient we are having is 3 by 2. So this can also be the possibility. So B and D up till now can be a possibility of having a gradient of 3 by 2. Now 4 plus 2x equals to 3y. So we can write this as 3y equals to 2x plus 4, or y equals to 2 by 3x plus 4 by 3. Now the gradient of over here would be 2 by 3, which is not what we are looking for. So this cannot be the right option. So the right option would be B or D. Question 12. In the figure above, the diameter of the circle is 20. So the radius would be 10. And the area of the shaded region. So these are the shaded region. These are your shaded region. The area of the shaded region is 80 pi. So what is the value of A plus B plus C plus D? So A plus B plus C plus D. Now, one thing for sure, that the diagram, it might seem that this is your diameter, but again, we are not sure. So we shouldn't be just going towards what the figure looks like. So, but we do know one thing, that the radius is 10. So area equals to pi r square, or pi into 10 square, that is 100 pi. So the area of the shaded region is 80 pi. The area of unshaded region, which is this, would be 20 pi. So if total area is 100 pi minus 80 pi, you're left with 20 pi. So shaded region would be 80 pi over 100 pi, or we can say 4 upon 5. Unshaded region would be 20 pi over 100 pi, that is 1 by 5. So 4/5 of the circle is shaded and 1/5 of the circle is not shaded. So if we have 360 degrees, so the unshaded degrees would be how much? So 1 upon 5 into 360 equals to 72. Now these two angles, this angle and this angle, both of them, if we combine both of them, they would be equal to 72. So A plus B plus this angle, let's suppose this is X, then this will also be X. A plus B plus X, both of them, if we add all three of them, they should be equal to 180. And then again, X, this X plus C plus D, this should also be equal to 180. So if you add all of them up, they should be equal to 360. So in a triangle, we have 180 degrees. In two triangles, we'll be having 360 degrees. Now A plus B plus C plus D equals to 360 minus 2X. And we know that this X, if we add X and this X, we get 72. So 2X equals to 72. So 360 minus 72 equals to 288. So option E is correct. Now each integer from 1 to 50 whose unit digit is 3 is written on a slip of paper and placed in a box. So we can have a unit digit, we can have 3, we can have 13, we can have 23, we can have 33, we can have 43. So these are numbers which are in between 1 and 50, and the units, they equal to 3 as well. If two slips of paper are drawn at random, what is the probability that both the numbers picked are prime? So this is a prime number, this is a prime number, this is a prime number, this is not a prime number, and 43 is also a prime number. So the probability of picking the first number that is prime would be 4/5. The probability of picking another prime number, so we have already picked up a prime number, so we are left with 3 prime numbers now, and we are left with 4 total numbers. So if, let's suppose, if we pick 3, then how many prime numbers are left? 13, 23, and 43. That is, the total number equals to 3 as far as prime number is concerned. But the total number inclusive of a non-prime number, then it's 4. So 4 and 4 cancels out and we get 3 by 5. So the probability would be 3 by 5. Again, if we do this question, we have 5 different possibilities. This is not a prime number. So selecting a first prime number would be 4/5. So we have 4 prime numbers. Total number equals to 5. If we select one prime number, then we are left with three prime numbers, and the total numbers that we are left would be 4. 4 and 4 cancel, you get 3 by 5. Now over here we have a diagram. So if 1 million vehicles were stolen in 1994, so 1994 is your base year. Now this square represents number of offenses known, and circle represents rate per 100,000 inhabitants. So if there are 100,000 inhabitants, for example, if the number is 5, it means there are 5 vehicles that are stolen in a total of 100,000 inhabitants. Now, if 1 million vehicles were stolen in 1994, so this is your base year, how many were stolen in 1996? So actually the graph is going down. So 1996, the number of offenses known, so minus 9.4. So 9.4% less vehicles were stolen. So 1 million in 1994. So 9.4 less, 9.4% of 1 million is 94,000. So 1 million minus 94,000 equals to how much? So 1 million minus 94,000 equals to, so 90,000 is 900,000, 910,000, so 4,000 more. So this would be 906,000. So 94,000. So 1 million minus 94,000 equals to 906,000. So the percentage that actually went down was 9.4. So 9.4% of 1 million equals to 94,000. So if you subtract 1 million from 94,000, we get 106,000. So the correct answer is option B. Now, by what percent did the number of vehicles stolen decrease from 97 to 98? This is your base year. Let's suppose it's 100. Now, 97, the number decreased by 12%. So in 1997, 88 vehicles were stolen. So 12% of 100 is 12. So in the base year, 100 vehicles were stolen, let's suppose. So in 97, 88 vehicles would be would be stolen. In 1998, so the decrease is 19.4%. So if 100 vehicles were stolen at base year, then in 98, 80.6 vehicles would be stolen. So what is the percentage decrease? So we go from 88 to 80.6. So 80.6 divided by 88 minus 1. That would be 80.6 minus 88 divided by 88. Or we can say 7.4 divided by 88. 7.4 divided by 88. So it is a number that would be obviously less than 10%. If it was 10%, then this, the numerator would be 8.8. So it's a number that is less than 10%. So either it can be A, B, or C. Now, can it be 8%? Can it be 8%? So 88 into 0.08, or 88 into 8 over 100. So 88 into 8 would be how much? So 80 into 8 is 640. And 88 is a 64. So this would be 704 divided by 100, that is 7.04. So 7.04, if it was 8%, then the answer, then the number of this 7.4 should have been 7.04. But it is not 7.04, it is a bit higher than 7.04, then the correct answer would be C. Option C would be the right answer. And you can also do it like this. So 7.4 divided by 88, if you use your calculator, you get 8.084. That is 8.4%. So option C is correct. Now, to the nearest percent, by what percent did the population of United States increase from 94 to 98? From 94 to 98. So let's suppose in 1994, 100 vehicles were stolen. In 1998, there were 80.6 vehicles were stolen. So 80.6 vehicles would be stolen. Now, in 98, we also know that this line is telling us rate per 100,000 inhabitants. So if there were 100,000 inhabitants, so how many vehicles were stolen? So in the base year, 100 vehicles were stolen. So in 1998, how many vehicles would be stolen? So 100 into 22.4% is 22.4. So 100 minus 22.4 equals to 77.6. So if there were 100,000 people, 77.6 vehicles were stolen. Now, how many people would have been there if 80.6 actual number of vehicles stolen were 80.6? So 100,000 into 80.6 divided by 77.6. And if you do the maths by calculator, this number would be 1.038, or the increase would be by 3.8%. So the correct option would be D. So if 77.6 vehicle was stolen when there were 100,000 inhabitants, actual number of vehicles stolen were 80.6, then obviously the number of inhabitants would be more than 100,000. So how much more than 100,000? So that would be 80.6 divided by 77.6 minus 1. So this will going to give you the percentage, that is approximately 3.8%. Hence option D is correct. Now if the average of V, W, X, Y and Z equals to 12.3. So if we divide this by 5, we get 12.3. So V plus W plus X plus Y plus Z would be equal to 61.5. And the average of V plus W equals to 45.6. So V plus W equals to 91.2. So V plus W, this equals to 91.2. Now, what is the average of X, Y, and Z? So X plus Y plus Z. Now, V plus X equals, divided by 5 equals to 12.3. So V plus X plus V plus W plus V plus W plus X plus Y plus Z equals to 61.5. We know that V plus W equals to 91.2. So V plus W plus X plus Y plus Z equals to 61.5. V plus W equals to 91.2. Then X plus Y plus Z would be 61.5 minus 91.2. So 61.5 minus 91.2 equals to 29.7. So X plus Y plus Z equals to 29.7. So we need to find out the average. So divide this by 3. So 29.7 divided by 3. So 9 threes are 27. So we are left with 2.7. So 9.9 would be the right answer. So 29.7 divided by 3 equals to 9.9. And minus 9.9, because this is minus 29.7. So 61.5 minus 91.2 is minus 29.7. So minus 29.7 divided by 3 would be minus 9.9. Now at Taylor High School, there are twice as many girls than boys. So let's suppose there are 100 girls, then there would be 50 boys. On the yearbook staff, at one meeting, staff meeting, the percentage of girls attending was twice as the percentage of boys. Now you can take any number. Let's suppose girls were attending, 40% of the girls were attending, then the boys would be attending 20%. 40% of 100 is 40, and 20% of 50 equals to 10. So the total number of students that were attending were 50. So what percent of those attending were boys? So 10 divided by 50 equals to 20%. So option A is Correct. Now, if four boys can shovel a driveway in 2 hours, so four boys can shovel a driveway in 2 hours, so how many hours there would be? Total number of hours required would be 8 hours. So each boy is utilizing 2 hours, so the total number of hours that needs to be used equals to 8. So how many minutes would it take 5 boys to shovel that driveway? So the total number of hours required equals to 8 into 60 minutes or 8 hours divided by 5, because now we have 5 boys. So 60 divided by 5 is 12. 8 into 12 is 96. So 96 minutes would be used. So in 1950, Roberto is 4 times as old as Joanne. So if Joanne is X, Roberto is 4X. In 1955, so Roberto would be 4X plus 5, so 5 years later, and Joanne would be equal to X plus 5. Now Roberto is 3 times as old as Joanne. So if you Joanne multiply by 3 would equal to Roberto's age. So Roberto is 3 times as old as Joanne. So X plus 5 into 3 equals to 4X plus 5. So 3X plus 15 equals to 4X plus 5. X would equal to 10. Now X is 10. So in 1950, Joanne is 10 years old. Now how old was Roberto when Joanne was born? So in 1950, Roberto is 40 years old. 10 years before, when Joanne was born, Roberto must have been 30 years old. So the correct answer is D. Now, in the end, you need to do a lot of practice so that you can get a perfect score. Thank you very much, class.